Thank you once again for joining us for our worship here in the Liverpool South Methodist Circuit. We do hope that you found these online services a source of inspiration or perhaps comfort during the last few months. It does seem light at the end of the tunnel as we see hairdressers, coffee shops and restaurants opening. We pray that soon we'll be worshipping together in familiar surroundings. However, we know that whether we're worshipping in our own houses or in a church building, that our God is with us. We're delighted that our Chair of District, Sheryl Anderson, is preaching for us today, and we look forward to hearing what she has to say to us. First, a prayer. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, as we meet to worship you, quieten our minds, still our hearts, for your living ways are all we seek. Strengthen our lives, inspire our spirits, in your living waters flow endless grace. Amen.
Hey. Let us pray. Dear God, I am sorry when I get so carried away with the busyness of each day, never stopping to dwell in your love. I'm sorry when I allow the stresses and demands of work or family to erode and wear away my hope. I'm sorry when I'm caught up in conflict and frustration, when I harbour resentment instead of giving out forgiveness. I'm sorry when I seek to be fulfilled by food, drink, or entertainment, yet fail to feast on your truth. I'm sorry when I desire the wrong things, blinded by the media, and forget to engage with the real treasures of love and justice. You are all love, all hope, all forgiveness, all truth, and all I really need. Amen. We will now say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
I have heard my people cry, all who dwell in dark and sin, my hand will save.
I who made the stars of night, I will make the darkness bright, I will speak my word to them, whom shall I save?
Here I am, Lord, is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go, Lord, if you lead me. I will hold your people in my heart.
Hearts for love alone, I will speak my word to them. Whom shall I send?
Here I am, Lord. Is it I, Lord? I have heard you calling in the night. I will go. If you lead me,
life through the Spirit. Therefore, there is now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus, because through Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life set me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law was powerless to do in that it was weakened by the sinful nature, God did by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful humanity to be a sin offering. And so he condemned sin in our sinful nature, in order that the righteous requirements of the law might be fully met in us, who do not live according to the sinful nature, but according to the Spirit. Those who live according to the sinful nature have their minds set on what the nature desires, but those who live in accordance with the Spirit have their minds set on what the Spirit desires. The mind controlled by the sinful nature is death, but the mind controlled by the Spirit is life and peace. The sinful mind is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law, nor can it do so. Those controlled by the sinful nature cannot please God. You, however, are controlled not by the sinful nature, but by the Spirit. If the Spirit of God lives in you, and if anyone does not have the Spirit of Christ, that person does not belong to Christ. But if Christ is in you, your body is dead because of sin, yet your spirit is alive because of righteousness. And if the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead is living in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his Spirit who lives in you.
Hi again, Andrew here. Now, nice to talk to you again. Just here to talk to you for our kids slot this week. And this week we're looking at one of Jesus' stories. We're looking at the story of the sower. So this is where there's a farmer, and he goes out and he throws loads of seed around his field, and it lands in four different places. And Jesus tells us a little bit about what those different places might represent, what they might mean. So first of all, we need to ask the question, who do all of these things in this story represent? So we've got the farmer there. Jesus explains just after he's told everyone this story that the farmer represents God. Okay, so God is walking around a field sowing some seed. So if that is God, what does the field represent? Jesus says that the field represents us, and the seed comes and lands on us, which is again a bit weird. So what does Jesus say the seed is? Can you see? Jesus says that the seed represents God's word, God's message about Jesus going out into the world and landing on people. Okay, so this story is all about how we hear the message about Jesus and what our reactions to the message about Jesus is. So Jesus says that there's four kinds of people in this story, four kinds of people that hear the message about Jesus and react in different ways. Okay, but the most exciting thing is a field can't change anything about itself, but we can. So we can listen to Jesus' story and we can learn something about ourselves. We can change. So let's have a look at the four different kinds of people that Jesus says that there is who listen to God's word. So the first one was really, really hard, compacted down soil, had been trodden over for a long time, and it's too hard and it's not letting the seeds into the soil at all. What would you do if you were trying to plant seeds in soil like that was so hard? What would you do? I think I would try and get in there and I would try and break up that soil to make it a bit softer, to make sure that the seeds can go in nicely and start growing. So this kind of person, Jesus says, has hardened their heart to God's message. They refuse to understand it and they refuse to let God's message into their heart. So anyone who thinks they're in the first one should really try and soften their heart to God, listen to him really well, and start to try and let him in and stop turning him away like the hard soil would. So anyone in the second one, this one, the rocky soil, and this one's all about how deep your roots are, okay? Now, roots in the Bible are all about understanding well, and about spending time, and about letting your faith develop, okay? So this person, Jesus says, really, really keen on Jesus, and absolutely loves Jesus for a few weeks, and then sort of forgets about it, and doesn't go to church, doesn't read their Bible, doesn't pray, and doesn't let God into their life long term. So their roots start to get really small. They don't develop very big. So this person, if you're this person, then I would say stick with God for a long time. Okay, let those roots develop. Read the Bible, come to church, pray. Let your roots develop deep, so that when the sun comes up, when you really start to struggle and feel the heat, then you're ready and you're prepared, and your roots are deep enough so that you can survive it. Okay, lovely. Let's go on to soil number three. So Jesus says that this one is all about the thorns and weeds and worries and anxieties of life, that they crowd out your faith and your relationship with God. So this person, I think this person is probably quite a worrier. So I think this person needs to talk to God and to say, God, help me trust you more. And this fourth one, this one sounds amazing, because this one has got really good roots. It produces amazing fruit, and it's just an all-round amazing soil. So that's a really, really good one. So I think we should all be aiming for this one. And I think all of us could work on our soil, can't we? Because sometimes we can be a bit stubborn and say, no, God, I'm not going to listen to you. I'm going to do my own thing. Sometimes we don't stick with things. We get bored, we get lazy, we move on to other things. And we need to stick with God and do things regularly, so we establish our roots with him. And sometimes we worry about things that are going on around us, and we don't trust God in the way that we should. So I think we've all got something in here that we can work on, but we've got this. Jesus gives us this one as a really good picture, as something that we're aiming for. All right, so good luck this week with your gardening. I hope it goes well. And I'll see you next week. Bye.
Bread. The parable of the sower. The same day, Jesus went out of the house and sat by the lake. Such large crowds gathered around him that he got into a boat and sat in it while all the people stood on the shore. Then he told them many things in parables, saying, A farmer went out to sow his seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path, and the birds came and ate it up. Some fell on rocky places where it did not have much soil. It sprang up quickly because the soil was shallow, and when the sun came up, the plants were scorched, and they withered because they had no root. Other seed fell among thorns, which grew up and choked the plants. Still other seed fell on good soil, where it produced a crop, 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown. He who has ears, let him hear. Listen then to what the parable of the sower means. When anyone hears the message about the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what was sown in his heart. This is the seed sown along the path. What was sown on rocky places is the man who hears the word and at once receives it with joy. But since he has no root, he lasts only a short time. When trouble or persecution comes, because of the word, he quickly falls away. What was sown among the thorns is the man who hears the word. The worries of this life and the deceitfulness of wealth choke it, making it unfruitful. But what was sown on good soil is the man who hears the word and understands it. He produces a crop, yielding 100, 60, or 30 times what was sown.
Strengthen, serve, and teach, and live the word.
Words of tears and cries and laughter, prayers of faith and songs of praise. Let this house proclaim from floor to rafter, all are welcome.
Let us pray. We ask your blessing on Sheryl as she preaches your word. We pray that you will open our ears and our hearts. We will listen and reflect and take what we hear into the rest of our week. Amen.
Good morning. My name is Sheryl Anderson, and I am the chair of the Liverpool Methodist District. Given the gospel text for our worship this morning, I thought it would be good to welcome you to the manse garden, where because of the very warm, dry spring, followed by the wet, early summer, there is an abundance of goods. Of course, like any garden, there is the hardened path, the rocky ground, and the thorny patch, as well as the good soil. But I love to garden, and I love this garden. Consequently, I have some issues with Jesus' explanation of the parable in the second part of the reading, as this interpretation raises some troubling questions. For instance, who qualifies as good soil? Since soil cannot change itself, is there any hope for the hardened, rocky, and thorny places? Are these destined to be unproductive forever? And today is Action for Children Sunday. Before I was a minister, I worked with young people who got into trouble with the law. Many would describe such troubled and troubling youngsters as hard or rocky or prickly. But I know that often this kind of soil just needs a bit of work, some nourishment, some clearing out of the debris, possibility of some light and the opportunity to grow toward it. And I have seen lives turned around. It is very easy to be dismissive of those struggling in the wild and rocky parts of God's garden. And it is all God's garden, after all. Action for Children was set up by Thomas Bowman Stevenson over 150 years ago as his response to the poverty and destitution he encountered in the East End of London, where I come from. And surely as followers of Jesus, our task is to look at the bigger picture, to address, as Action for Children seeks to, not just poverty, disadvantage, and discrimination in our society, but the reasons for them. In this extraordinary season of COVID-19, it seems to me that there are three challenges that the pandemic is forcing us to face. One, the scandal of poverty, government economic improvement agenda. Two, religious plurality, that's the government tackling extremism agenda. And three is pollution, and that would be the government climate change agenda. The language we use to describe things says a lot about our beliefs and attitudes. As a Londoner, when I hear the word poverty, it conjures up for me images of Charles Dickens and slums and ragged children and squalor and desperation. You know what I mean. But politicians do not want us to think in those terms. Notice the language the government uses. You hear talk of ending child poverty, and so it has an economic improvement agenda. But the language is designed to make us think in positive terms, not negative ones. In Liverpool, as in the other major cities in this country, we live in communities of religious plurality. All sorts of different people from all sorts of cultures, with different religious beliefs, customs, and practices. Given how important faith is to people who have it, it is not surprising that we might struggle to understand each other and cooperate with each other. The government, however, speaks in terms of tackling extremism. For our rulers, religion is a private affair unless it threatens the security of the state. This has been nowhere more obvious than conversations with government departments about the opening of places of worship, first for private prayer and then for public worship. At a meeting recently of faith leaders, we had a discussion about the challenges. Our concerns were remarkably similar. How many people does it take to open a synagogue? Well, of course, it takes 10. And if you're an observant Jew, it takes 10 men to open a synagogue. The whole point of Friday prayers for the Muslim community is that the whole Muslim community gathers. Imam said it's usually 2 meters, two millimeters apart, not 2 meters. The language we use, the way we speak about things, issues people really matters. What do you think of when you hear the words climate change? But actually, we are talking about pollution, about the way we humans treat the world, our home, like a dustbin. So why don't we, you and I, the government, the media, why don't we call it that? Jesus understood how important language is, about how people do not hear what you are saying unless you use particular images and words that will help them to get hold of the message you want to communicate. And even then, there is no guarantee. A sower went out to sow, and some seed fell on the path, and some on rocky ground, and some among thorns. The path is the place that gets walked over. Lots of feet compacting the soil, making it hard and unable to receive the seed. Who are the people who get walked over in our world? Who are the people most exposed, vulnerable, and open to exploitation? I suggest it is the poor. Globally, the poor have been most affected by the virus. If you are poor, you are more likely to contract it and more likely to die as a result. A rocky ground is the place where there is no depth. The soil is shallow, and although the seed sprouts up quickly, once the sun comes out, it dries up and it dies. Who are the people who lack depth in our world? Who is it who expects to find easy solutions to complex problems? Who think that the answers are simple and all that needs to happen is everyone just needs to think like me? I suggest it is the fundamentalists of all ideologies and beliefs. We cannot tolerate difference and diversity. Do you know that almost 100 mobile telephone masts have been set on fire because of the belief by some that it is the 5G network, not the virus, that is making people sick? The thorns are not supposed to be there. They are on the edge of the field, left over because the farmer didn't clear up properly, right to the edge. And thorns have a habit of taking over if you do not keep careful eye on them, choking the goodness out of anything that competes with them. Who are the people taking over, choking the goodness out of our planet, so determined to compete and win that they disregard goodness in the people or situations around them? I suggest global capitalism, global business, denying the evidence that their economic activity destroying our world, our home. I suggest these people have some things to answer. And what about us, you and me? Who are we in Jesus' story? What do we hear? This is aimed at others, of course. We are the good soil. But are we willing to hear what Jesus is saying? God's love cannot be heard, cannot take root when there is poverty, extremism, and pollution in our world or in our lives. If we are honest with ourselves, we can probably find evidence of several kinds of soil in our lives and in our congregations on any given day. It is noteworthy that Jesus does not use the parable to exhort hearers to be good soil, as though by ourselves we could make that happen. If there is any hope for the unproductive soil, and that includes us, it is that the sower keeps sowing generously, extravagantly, even in the least promising places. Jesus' investment in his disciples show that he simply will not give up on them, in spite of their many failings. We trust that he will not give up on us either, but will keep working on whatever is hardened, rocky or thorny within us and among us. The good news in the parable is that there is always the possibility for change. If you need any proof of that, look at what Action for Children do in the most unpromising of situations. As we begin to look at the possibility of meeting again for public worship, we might also consider the implications of this parable for how we engage in mission. Too often we play it safe, sowing the word only where we are confident it will be well received, and only where those who receive it are like us and will not upset the way we like to do things. We avoid the hard, rocky, thorny places, and in the name of stewardship we hold tightly to our resources, wanting to make sure that nothing is wasted. We stifle creativity and energy for mission, resisting new ideas for fear they might not work, as though mistakes or failure were to be avoided at all costs. Jesus' approach to mission is quite at odds with our play-it-safe instincts. He gives us the freedom to take risks for the sake of the gospel. He endorses extravagant generosity and sowing the word even in perilous places. Though we may wonder about the wisdom or efficiency of his methods, Jesus promises that the end result will be a bumper crop. And if you think about it, we know this is true, for we are part of the crop. We are the seed corn for the next generation. Thanks be to God.
And now we have our prayers of intercession. And I would like to begin with Psalm 142. I call to the Lord for help. I plead with him. I bring him all my complaints. I tell him all my troubles. When I am ready to give up, he knows what I should do. And because this weekend is the weekend of Action for Children, Lord, we would like to lift up the work of Action for Children. We think of all the families who come into contact with the charity and pray your blessing over them. We think of those struggling with their physical or mental health and pray that your peace descends on them. Lord, remove any barriers that may prevent people from reaching out. We thank you for the thousands of staff members and volunteers who serve the children and their families, and we pray that you would sustain them. Give them the energy and enthusiasm they need to lovingly support those who are most in need. We thank you too for the infrastructure that makes Action for Children's work possible. The buildings, the vehicles, the IT, all the variables that help them to reach and serve communities right across the UK. We pray for the leadership and the trustees. May your wisdom and guidance be present as they map out the future of the charity. We also pray for our wider society, and we ask that your will be done from Westminster all the way down to our own communities. We ask for success with the human trials of the new UK coronavirus vaccine that have just begun. We would bring before you the churches that are planning to restart worship services and give thanks for all the homes that have become places of worship during this lockdown. We think of family and friends who are finally able to reconnect in person once again. And also for those who continue to need to shield, who are not free as yet. We think of all those who are anxious and fearful about the new freedoms as lockdown restrictions ease further. And we ask that each one of us might experience your peace, God, amid whatever may be going on around us. We ask all of this in the name of Christ our Saviour. Amen.
No condemnation now.
Well, thank you once again for joining us, and to the folks who've worked hard, as they've been doing each week, to put this service together. Over 150 years ago, the Reverend Thomas Bowman Stevenson took the time to listen to homeless children living under the arches of Waterloo Station. He listened. From one family home in Waterloo, he established a charity which quickly grew to become the National Children's Home. Today, as Action for Children, they hold tight their founder's pioneering spirit and drive forward new ways to make life better for vulnerable children. Last year, they helped more than 387,000 children and families across the UK. This Sunday is Action for Children's Sunday. Many of us support or will have supported this charity in the past, and maybe we could consider supporting them again. Their website is www.actionforchildren.org.uk. So now let's close our act of worship by saying the grace together. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all, now and forevermore. Amen.